Thank you, brother. Appreciate that music tonight. Really ministered my heart. Appreciate the truths of all the songs that we've sung. I love God and music.
Amen.
In the Lord's house. And out of the Lord's house, but I mean it's there is nothing better than hearing God's people singing.
That's right.
The praises of God. Yeah. And knowing that they're singing that from their heart.
Amen.
And that just thrills my soul. I want to say to the church, thank you so much for all your hospitality and your kindness, your generosity. I was overwhelmed by the love offering that you gave me. I am definitely not worthy of that, but I thank you for it. And I appreciate it. And I'm going to tell you something special about your church. I preach some meetings throughout the year. And I think this is the first one I've been in a long time. Now, when I was at Independence, they did their four-step. You know, every night we ate home cooking here. And that was a real blessing to me. And I just want to thank you, all the ladies. And if there's any men that can hit a lick, if you did anything at all, thank you for that too. But I want to just tell you, I appreciate all that you did to make this meeting possible. And my hope and prayer is that God will use His Word.
Amen.
Way beyond tonight.
Amen.
Let's go to God in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, how thankful we are that we can come in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to the very throne of grace.
Yes, Lord.
We are such a needy people that we should be spending a whole lot more time here, Lord. And I just thank you for the privilege as a child of God to say, Abba, Father.
Amen.
Tonight, I pray that you would cleanse us, Lord, of our sins, of worldliness, covetousness, evil thoughts, anything that would serve to distract us from your honor and your glory at this very moment and throughout the remainder of this evening. Lord, I know that there are lost folks here. I pray that you would open their hearts.
Amen.
And give them joy unspeakable and full of glory.
Amen.
That they might know the bitter dregs of repentance and the sweetness of saving faith.
Yes.
And that they might truly come to know the Savior. God, I thank you for the young people that are here tonight. And I ask, O Lord, that you would do a mighty work in their lives.
Yes, Lord.
That you would not only save them, but put a desire in their heart to serve you through your New Testament church. O God, I pray for our families that you would strengthen the bonds of holy matrimony between husband and wife, and also, Lord, bless as these men and women serve to raise their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. God, please bless the message tonight. I know all too well that without you, I can do nothing. Lord, please help me. Please, Lord, bless in our meeting tonight. with your presence and the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, help us to love you more. More than anyone or anything. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
If you would, turn in your Bibles, please, to Psalm chapter 37. And this, I'm sure, is a psalm you're very familiar with. Psalm 37. Verse 1. Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity. If you're saved here tonight, your mind ought not to be upon the workers of iniquity.
Amen.
Whatever worldly advantages they may enjoy, it should be nothing to you. Because ultimately, they're going to die in their sins if they don't trust Christ. Believe me, you've got far more as a believer.
Amen.
Than the wicked could ever hope to have.
Amen.
He says in verse 2, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Verse 3, trust in the Lord and do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass.
Amen.
And he shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, and thy judgment as the noonday. Rest in the Lord, and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. The title of my message tonight is The Secrets of Spiritual Tranquility. Now, by the time that David had penned these words, under the divine inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he was an old man. He had experienced the whole range of life. He says there in verse 25, I have been young and now am old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread.
Amen.
He is ever merciful and lendeth, and his seed is blessed. Now, David had experienced a lot of chastening, a lot of affliction, and yet at the end of his life, as he grew older, with all the changes that he experienced, he wasn't soured by the experiences of life. In fact, he was sweetened by the grace of God. And he offers us some valuable advice on how to live a life of spiritual tranquility as we trust, as we rest in our sovereign Lord, as we commit ourselves, body, soul, and spirit to our God. We're going to find that we're going to be able to experience a life of peace and joy and tranquility. Now, by way of contrast, David's son, who was one of the greatest kings, Solomon, vast possessions, you know how he ended his life?
Right.
He was a mess.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
He wrote the book of Ecclesiastes, and basically the theme of that book is all is vanity and vexation of spirit.
Right.
I don't know about you, but I want to grow old gracefully.
Amen. Amen.
The way that David recommends, by delighting in the power and the presence of the Lord. Now folks, we live in an age that is full of turmoil.
Amen.
perplexities, distractions. Tell you what, you don't have to look very far, and you'll see people that just have frazzled nerves, troublesome thoughts, and fearful struggles within. People are hurting. They're broken. They're undone. They're looking to the things of the world, and they're not finding any solace, any strength, any hope. As God's children, we ought to provide a living example of spiritual power, peace, strength, and soul tranquility. People ought to be able to look at your testimony and see that there is something so different by the way you live.
Amen.
By the attitude that you have, by the speech that comes out of your mouth. So, what does tranquil mean? Do you know what that means? What's that word mean? I looked it up. This is what I do. I believe in defining things.
Amen.
Tranquil means free from commotion or tumult. Peaceful. Quiet. Calm. Free from or unaffected by disturbing emotions. Unagitated.
Amen.
Serene. Placid. When I really got to the crux of the definition, I came to the idea that tranquility is all about freedom. And I think you'll see that this is really the theme that the psalmist gives us here. And the first one I want to address is freedom from self-trust. Notice what he says in verse 3. Trust in the Lord and do good.
Amen.
So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. And by the way, that first half of that verse, that's the right order. Until you trust in the Lord, you don't have the ability to do good. There is none good, no, not one. They're all gone out of the way. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death. Without Christ, you cannot do anything ultimately that is good in the sight of God, because it's polluted by sin.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
You know how you have freedom from self-trust? Everybody here's got Proverbs 3 memorized, right? Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy path.
Amen.
You know, there is so much spiritual freedom and tranquility when we trust the Lord in salvation. Because what essentially you are doing is you are coming to an end of yourself. You are recognizing, hey, I can't do it. I don't have what it takes. I'm guilty. I'm condemned. God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Amen.
Amen.
You see, when we trust Christ, we cease from our own righteousness, our own self-righteousness, to trust in the righteousness of Christ. Your righteousness is as filthy rags compared to His.
Amen.
That's why God won't accept it. The only way that you can be accepted before God is if you are accepted in the Beloved. There must be a divine union with Christ. God must look at you through the righteousness of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
We cease from our own works to trust fully in Christ's work for us. You know, this is hard for kids that are raised in church.
You're right.
Because they know the lingo. I mean, my kids, they knew everything. They knew the lingo. They knew the answers. They knew the memory verses. When my daughter was 17, she said, I think I need to be baptized. And I said, why? She said, well, I think it's the right thing to do. And I said, it is, but not for you. Because you got to know the Lord.
Amen.
You got to trust in what Christ did. You've got to recognize that you're a sinner. Now, later on, the Lord saved her. And she thanked me.
Amen.
For telling her what I told her.
Right.
You see, we've got to cease from trusting our religious opinions or the opinions of others to trust fully in God's Word and His promises. It's not what you know, it's who you know. Mm-hmm. I'm not trusting in a systematic form of Bible doctrine. I'm trusting in the living Christ.
Amen.
The one who took my sin on the cross,
Amen.
Who put them away, who purged them, who was buried, who rose again the third day. That's real to me.
Amen.
Changed my life forever.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
Can you trust the Lord? Tonight, do you recognize what you are? A sinner in need of a Savior? Can you lay everything else aside? All of your opinions, all of the religious notions you might have, and come and say, you know, I need Christ. Mm-hmm. More than anything else in the world. That's how I felt the day that I was saved. I did feel something. I don't believe salvation is just an intellectual thing.
You're right. Amen.
I got convicted of my sins. The day that I was saved, I can remember looking Gregory in the house right in the face and I said, I want to be saved right now!
Amen.
And that was it. You know, I think one of the best ways to illustrate saving faith, I'm sure you've heard the illustration of a man who was going to cross the Niagara Falls. Everybody heard that illustration? Great! Man, that's fine. Because see, I preach a lot of places, and sometimes people have heard this 6 or 8 times. Well, this guy, he announced that he was going to cross the Niagara Falls. He was going to stretch like a tightrope across it. And he told the people that he was going to walk over with a wheelbarrow. Now, a lot of people would used to walk over with a big pole. You've seen them do that. The Great Walendas. You ever heard of them? Well, he started handing out flyers. And I mean, this was a big event. People love to see failure. You know, there's a whole lot of people gathered thinking, this guy, we're going to see somebody crash into the falls. So a huge crowd gathered. I mean, and they're all there. There was a standing room only. And they begin to jeer. Hey, well, you're goofy, man. What's wrong with you? There's no way you're going to get across the falls. Guys that are walking across, and they're jeering, trying to distract him. He gets about a quarter of the way up through and kind of wobbles a little bit, and the people, oh. He gets about halfway through, and now there's a hush that's come over the crowd. They can't believe the guy's made it halfway. Here he is. And he's getting about 3/4 of the way. All of a sudden, there are shouts of cheering. People are amazed. And they're saying, go for it, man. You're almost there. And he gets all the way over. And people just began. I mean, it was bedlam. hearing. They couldn't believe that he had done this. That everybody, "What? You're amazing!" He said, "Be calm." Now, how many of you believe that I can cross the Niagara Falls with this wheelbarrow? Everybody starts, "We believe it, man! We saw it with our own eyes." He said, who wants to get in a wheelbarrow? If you believe it that much, will you get in the wheelbarrow and let me carry you back across? And I got to thinking about that. Isn't that what we do in Christ? Mm-hmm. You see, if somebody would have taken him up on the offer, if they really believed he could do it, they would have not contributed anything. They would have had to rest in that wheelbarrow and depend entirely on the ability, the coordination, the concentration, the performance of that man.
Yeah.
All they would have been doing is resting in the wheelbarrow. That's what salvation is.
Amen.
Amen.
I am resting in Christ. He's done something for me that I could never do on my own.
Amen.
And I don't contribute anything to it.
Amen.
I just say, I believe you can do it. Amen. I believe that you can take me all the way across Jordan.
Amen.
And take me all the way to glory.
Amen.
See, this happened to me 36 years ago.
Amen.
Changed my life so dramatically that I've been resting in Him ever since.
Amen.
Tonight, I have no fear of death. I'm ready. My dream is to be preaching.
Amen.
And the Lord take me.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
That, my wife always says, you know, people are going to get kind of upset when that happens. You know, that here's the preacher dead right in the front of the church. But I would love to go out preaching.
Amen. Amen.
I don't have a fear of death because Christ took the sting of it away.
Amen.
And He gave me eternal life. Do you know Him tonight? You see, by trusting God, what happens is you are free to serve Him and to bring forth fruit that is pleasing to Him for the first time in your life as we rely on His grace, His power, rather than our own. And it says there, trust in the Lord and do good, so shalt thou dwell in the land.
Amen.
The land of milk and honey. The land of God's promises. The land of God's grace that you can rely on and dwell in and walk in every single day from this day forward. And He says, verily thou shalt be fed. You ask anybody here that's saved, and they'll tell you that God has never let them go begging bread.
Amen.
Either physically or spiritually.
Amen.
You see, God feeds His children.
Yeah, He does.
He brings us into His banqueting house. His banner over us is love. And He feeds us and strengthens us and empowers us for each and every day. He renews our strength. So I pray tonight that you understand what it means to be free from self-trust. And that you understand what it means to just trust the Lord.
Amen.
Secondly, verse 4. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and He shall give thee the desires of thine heart. That's freedom from earthly carnal desires. Do you realize you complicate your life by desiring things that aren't going to do you a bit of good? Alexander McLaren said, "It is not our changing circumstances, but our unregulated desires that rob us of peace. You think about how complicated people make their lives. Mm-hmm. Because they have never understood how important it is to sanctify their desires, to set them apart for God. Because of carnal desires within our hearts that are set on perishable things, we often allow them to have power over us, disrupting our peace. Fleeting joys over things of little value make us restless and often filled with feelings of disappointment. When things don't turn out like you dream or envision, temporal things never fully satisfy.
Right.
We obtain something we had our hearts set on, only to find our desires fixed on something else. You ever notice that?
Mm-hmm.
Something you really want, you thought you really had to have, that car. Alright? And my mother always, she talks to my dad about this all the time, because when I was growing up, that was, he just had to have this car. And once he got that car, I'd love to have. And finally, what ruined me? Remember Ricardo Montalban? And he used to do those commercials about Cordoba and Corinthian leather and all that garbage. Well, my dad, old Ricardo, drew him in, see? You know, and he went out and bought him one with Corinthian leather. And I'm telling you, that thing was a lemon. Before they had lemon laws. All right? It was hard living with my mom. Every time she'd slide into that Corinthian leather, and that thing wouldn't start, or the air conditioning wouldn't work. But the point is, how many times have you done that too?
Right.
Exactly right.
You get your heart set on something and you find out that really temporal things really never satisfy.
Amen. You're right.
You got to have something else. You see, if we can learn to delight in God, in His Word, in His way, in His will, true peace and consistent tranquility will flood our being. And our desires will be filled up with Him.
Amen.
I love Psalm 73, the last four verses. And if you've ever read it, it's the Psalm of Asaph, who started out, he was envious at the wicked. And by the way, that's where a lot of your trouble comes from.
You're right.
You look at what other people have and you think, man, why don't I have that? I've seen wicked people, I mean just ungodly people, get brand new big SUV Mercedes. And there's part of me that's saying, man, I would look good in that. You know? If I had that thing, I'd put it in some good use. But I ain't never going to get one. You know what? If I were to get a big old SUV, Mercedes-Benz, would the next thing be a Rolls-Royce?
Yeah.
The point is, earthly things really can never satisfy a child of God.
Right.
But look what he says at the end of the psalm. He says in Psalm 73, in verse 24, thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. This ought to be our desire. Mm-hmm. Whom have I in heaven but thee?
Right.
And there is none upon earth that I desire beside thee.
Amen.
My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever.
Amen.
That's where we need to be. He says here in verse 28, but it is good for me to draw near to God.
Amen.
I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all thy works. You know what Colossians 3, 1 through 3 says? If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of the Father.
Amen.
Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth, for ye are dead.
Yes. Amen.
And your life is hid with Christ in God. What's that mean, dead? We're dead to that old way of life. We're alive, we're seated in heavenly places in
Amen.
Christ Jesus. Our hearts ought to be filled up with holy, sanctified desires
Amen.
That please Him.
Amen.
Amen.
McLaren said this, "This glad longing for God is the cure for all feverish unrest of desires unfulfilled. Quietness fills the soul
Amen.
Which delights in the Lord." Think how surely rest comes with delighting in God. For that soul must needs be calm, which is free from the distractions of various desires by one master attraction, the Lord God Himself.
Yeah.
Are you free? Do you recognize how important it is to be free from earthly desires that will never satisfy you? And learn to delight yourself in the Lord. And the rest of that verse, He'll give you the desires of your heart. When we delight in the Lord and we draw our joy and strength and satisfaction from Him, He will sanctify every desire.
Amen.
You see, delight in God puts our desires in their proper place. In God's will. In obedience to His command. And what happens is, you won't look at everything you do as a chore.
Amen.
Right, amen.
But rather as an honor, a privilege.
Right.
To serve the King. Psalm 27:4 says it like this, "One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple." In the province of God, I didn't have the privilege, and it is a grand privilege, if you've been raised in a house where your parents love the Lord Jesus Christ.
Right.
And the Lord's church. There is not a better place on earth than a home where desires are sanctified by the Lord God Himself in your hearts.
Amen. Amen.
I didn't have that privilege. And I'm going to tell you, a lot of young people sometimes think, what am I missing? Nothing.
Amen.
Amen.
I've drank of the polluted streams of this whole wicked world, and it's corrupt.
You're right.
It's ruinous. You look at how many people are so despairing that they can't get through a day unless they pop pills or shoot their arm full
right.
of heroin.
You're right.
You look at this whole world, and you got people that are so down that every night they've got to drink themselves to sleep.
Right.
Do you want to live like that? It's a horrible way to live.
You're right. Amen.
And yet our world is being overwhelmed with that.
That's right.
Young people, I'm praying that God will use you to raise your children in the fear and admonition of
Amen.
The Lord. That God will save them and raise up a generation that will stand for truth and godliness.
Amen.
Amen.
See, delight in God puts our desires in the proper place. Open your mouth wide and God will fill it. It says that He'll give you the desires of your heart. Make your petitions known in the form having spiritual desires. Desire more grace, more holiness, more love, more knowledge of Christ, more concern for the lost, and see if God will not fill you up.
Amen.
Amen.
With spiritual grace and blessings. The reality of it is, just looking at you all, you've got food and raiment. Mm-hmm. Some of us got more food than others. But we have what God says we're to be content with. But you know what else you've got? You've got a roof over your head.
Amen.
You've got friends and family that love you. You've got a measure of health.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
You got people right here in this body that love you and are concerned for you. Listen, don't underestimate what you have here. There are blessings beyond measure that the world can never give you.
Amen.
Amen.
Thirdly, verse 5. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in Him, and He shall bring it to pass. This is freedom from the perplexity of choosing our own path. How much trouble and distress do we bring upon ourselves by making bad decisions on a daily basis? We try to figure things out on our own by mere human rationale, and we're often filled with worry and doubts, even over the most trifling of things that will mean nothing in eternity.
Right.
Yeah.
Why? Why do we? It's because we often want to choose our own way and walk in the flesh.
Right.
That's why we get tore up. God says, this is the way, walk ye in it. Mm-hmm. And it's so much simpler to follow His way than to try to blaze your own trail. How much tranquility and peace we would have if we learned to commit our ways to the Lord and allow Him to direct our steps. Think about this. You don't even know what's going to happen to you tomorrow. You have no idea what's going to happen, but God does. Known unto God are all His works from the foundation of the world. So what do? Lord, I'm committing my way to You.
Amen.
Do with me as You will. Lord, what wilt Thou have me to do? Where would You have me go? What will You have me say?
Amen.
How will You have me act? Lord, I'm Yours.
Amen.
I'm committing everything in Your care. Commit your way unto the Lord.
Amen.
You see, He knows what's ahead, and He knows the best place to take. See, two great keys that open up the secret place of the Most High are joy in God and trust in His guidance.
Amen.
He knows what's best.
Amen.
Let God be your pillar of fire to blaze the way and guide you and direct you. Let His Word be your guide. Let His Spirit open your mind to the truth of His Word so that you can walk in His ways.
Amen.
Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in Him, and He'll bring it to pass. You know, animals who are stubborn need bits and bridles. They have to, and of course, I've never had one in my mouth, but they look painful to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And to get a horse's attention, I guess sometimes you've got to kind of jerk that bridle a little bit in order to get him turned the right way. You know what? I would much rather be guided by God's grace, mm-hmm. His eye.
Amen.
There's a verse in the Bible that He'll guide you with His eye. Now, have you ever experienced that? When I was growing up, my dad didn't know nothing about the Bible. But if he looked at me a certain way when I was misbehaving,
right,
he was guiding me with his eye.
Yep.
Because I knew that if I didn't pay attention to the way he was looking at me, he wasn't going to guide me with his eye. He was going to whoop the fire out of me.
Right.
I did get whippings, lots of them. And I believe in spanking children.
Amen.
Amen.
Is that on tape? Right. Hillary Clinton will probably come after us. You see, to commit to him involves submission. And a willingness to be led of the Spirit and the Word in a way that pleases him. And God will guide us with his eye if our eyes are fixed upon him, with a sincere willingness to obey. Spurgeon said, "Roll the whole burden of life upon the Lord. Lead with Jehovah not the present fretfulness merely, but all thy cares. In fact, submit the whole tenor of thy way to him. Cast away anxiety, resign thy will, submit thy judgment, leave all with the God of all."
Amen. Amen.
Do you realize how much freedom you have when you commit everything to him? And you rest in his guidance, in his direction? I can guarantee you something. God's word will never direct you wrong.
Amen.
God's Spirit will never lead you into wickedness or sin. It's safe to commit your way unto the Lord. And then what a wonderful phrase that he has. Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass.
Amen.
How comforting is that?
Amen.
Have you ever committed something unto the Lord, and by faith you really laid it there?
Yeah.
And then you saw God work it out. And he brought it to pass. And it just filled your heart with joy. It fed your heart with faith.
Amen.
That strengthened you for the next trial, the next difficulty that you face. You can remember, you know what, I committed my way to him then. I saw how he brought it to pass. I'm going to trust him right now. Lord,
amen.
I'm doing it again.
Amen.
I'm committing my way to you.
Amen.
God knows the way that's best. Let us labor to submit every step to his wise leadership and to his sovereign control. So many people file things up because they want to force their own selfish, willful agenda on God. Trust him to guide you. He is able.
Amen.
The poet said, "Thy way not mine, O Lord, however dark it be. O lead me by thine own right hand. Smooth let it be or rough, it will be still the best. Winding or straight, it matters not. It leads me to thy rest."
Amen.
Amen.
"I dare not choose my lot, would not if I might. But choose thou for me, O my God. Take thou my cup, and it with joy or sorrow filled, as ever best to thee may seem. Choose thou my good and ill." One last point. Everybody loves when the preacher says that, don't they? I know you. I think you're a special church, but I know you're sinners. Now, some preachers, you ever heard these preachers that say, my last point is? And then they go about seven more points? I call them Pharaoh. You know why I call them that? Pharaoh wouldn't let the people go. Now I'm going to let you go. After his last point. It says here in verse 7, rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him.
Amen.
Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil, for evildoers shall be cut off. But those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth.
Amen.
This is a freedom from the anxiety of an unknown future. You know, so many people fear the future.
That's right.
And spend countless hours worrying about things that they have absolutely no control over. I couldn't control the day of my birth. That was fixed by God. I can't control the day of my death. As it is appointed unto man once to die, and after this the judgment.
Amen.
But your whole life in between those two big events, think about how often you get worried about something and it causes you to lose sleep. It irritates you throughout the day because you can't come to a settled conclusion because you've got so much anxiety about what you're envisioning that lies ahead.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, don't waste your time with that. Mm-hmm. Rest in the Lord. Commit your way to Him and believe that He has your future in His hand.
Yes.
If you're saved. You see, others fear the future because they know in the deep recesses of their heart that they're not right with God. And they tremble at the thought of spending an eternity in the torments of the lake of fire. Now, this is very serious, what I'm going to say right now. If you're lost in your sins tonight, you are more accountable than most people are. Because you have heard and seen. You heard the gospel preached clearly, accurately, scripturally. You have seen God work in people's hearts. And you know that there's power that changes lives. And if you die in your sins, with your sins, they're going to belong to you throughout all eternity.
Right.
Amen.
Amen. That's it.
And tonight, I have presented to you the only way that you can have your sins paid for. It's through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And I've also showed you that it's not just a deliverance from hell. I've showed you this is a life that is far better than anything you will ever taste in the world.
Amen.
Amen.
There's joy in serving God. Even on my lowest days,
Amen.
I can say, I'm saved, man. I'm going to heaven.
Amen.
I've got a wife that loves me, kids that love me, grandkids that love me, a great church. I've got all the promises
Amen.
That are yea and amen in Christ Jesus. I've got the Word of God, the Spirit dwelling in me
Amen.
On my worst day.
Amen. Amen.
I've got it far better than those that are in the world who may have everything that money can buy.
Right.
Amen.
What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul?
Right. Amen.
Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Now, if you have that kind of fear tonight, it's justified. If you've not taken refuge in Christ, and you've not rested in His finished work, you should be fearful of your future.
Amen.
Rest, weary soul. The penalty is borne, the ransom paid. For all thy sins, full satisfaction made. Strive not to do thyself what Christ has done. Claim the free gift and make the joy thine own. No more by pangs of guilt and fear distressed. Rest, sweetly rest.
Yes, amen.
What a blessing to rest in the Lord.
Amen.
And to wait patiently for Him. You know, when you find yourself doing that, you won't get as angry as you used to. You won't get so fretful. You won't get bitter over your circumstances. Rest in His attributes. The God that I serve tonight, He's sovereign.
Amen.
He's gracious.
Amen.
He's the most loving person in all the universe.
Amen.
He's holy. Righteous. He's never made a mistake. I'm resting in Him. Rest in His will. It's right here in His Word.
Yes.
It's all laid out for you. You want to know how to live? It's right here. Rest in that. Rest in His promises. Rest in His ability. Rest in Him to take you all the way to glory. I've got a 6 or 7 hour drive tomorrow for Lord. If I don't make it to my earthly home, I'm going to my heaven now.
Amen.
I believe with all my heart to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And there is coming a grand and glorious day when I'm going to take my place with all the blood-washed throne.
Amen.
The elect of all ages. Dressed in spotless white,
amen.
Singing, worthy is the Lamb that was slain.
Amen.
Who has redeemed us to God by His blood out of every nation, kindred, tribe, and tongue.
Amen.
Amen.
I want to be right there with them. I want to be singing, lifting up my voice with joy and thanksgiving and worshiping the One who loved me and gave Himself for me.
Amen.
And I'll hear my Savior say to the Father, behold, I and the children which Thou hast given me,
amen.
They're all accounted for. Everyone I died for, they all have the garments of salvation.
Amen.
They're all right here. They're all beholding Your glory.
Amen.
I'm resting in that tonight.
Amen.
Because I believe God is able.
Amen.
I pray tonight you know what it is to have spiritual tranquility.